What I say, you all are going to be smiling and having a good time. So thank you, Trisha, for putting me at this spot. My name is Dennis Ojo. I was born and raised in Los Angeles. I am a proud child of Nigerian immigrants, and I am a proud South Central scholar. Thank you. I consider it to be one long, incredible journey. From my mother's village in Onitsha, Ogona, Nigeria, to where I stand today, a new American. See, I knew it. Dessert, lots of claps. Each step along the thousands of miles were made possible by the stepping stones of education. My mother's father passed away when she was just 9 years old.
Is that your son?
Yes.
But she never forgot one important lesson that he left her, and that was that she could be materially poor, but she could not afford to be academically poor. She was determined not to let him down, and so she excelled in school despite her hardships. She won a government scholarship, much like South Central scholars, to pursue a higher education in the United States, and she arrived in this country, her only companion being the suitcase that she was carrying. 30 years later, now working as a social worker in Los Angeles, my mom was able to better her life, my life, and the lives of many others in our family because she chose to pursue her education. My mother made sure that at a young age, I knew precisely how important education was to her remarkable story. As I grew older, I developed a sense of duty to her and my ancestors to make the most of the special opportunity I have to be in this country. I'm excited to share that education continues to be an important part of my story. I graduated from Harvard College last year with a degree in government, and next year I will begin at Harvard Law School. At Harvard Law School, I hope to focus my studies on civil rights and civil liberties, especially in the areas of education, housing, and the criminal justice system. While I sincerely enjoy the work that I now do as a youth organizer in South Central, I believe that taking up this course in law school will equip me with a better understanding of how to advocate for the most disadvantaged people in our society, the previously incarcerated dad that is still trying to reintegrate into society, the single mother who is looking for affordable housing, the child in South Central that still doesn't have a quality education. In the fall of 2014, shortly before the midterm elections, I teamed up with a resident tutor to co-create a video project called Harvard Takes the 1964 Louisiana Literacy Test. We gave a real test administered by the state of Louisiana in 1964. We gave that to my classmates at Harvard. And guess what? Not a single one of them passed. Not a single Harvard student was able to pass this literacy test that was required to vote in Louisiana. And you'll see that this test was designed to be impossible to pass. And yet tests like these were used for many years to prevent thousands of people who look like me from voting. When I was doing research for this literacy test project, I came across the book Parting the Waters by historian Taylor Branch. It is a comprehensive history of the civil rights movement. The book is full of a number of memorable stories, but there was one individual in particular who kept popping up as a truly heroic figure. Born and raised in a housing project in Harlem, our honored guest tonight, Bob Moses is one of the most influential figures of the civil rights movement and frankly in American history. He is best known for developing the idea for the Mississippi Freedom Summer Project in 1964, which recruited Northern college students to join the Mississippi Blacks conducting a grassroots voter registration drive there. He is also known for developing the Algebra Project, a national program to improve the math literacy skills of children in poor communities. But it was not until I looked more closely into Mr. Moses' story of how he got involved in the movement that I truly understood why he is such a special figure in American history. With a Harvard master's degree in philosophy already to his name, it would have been easy for Bob Moses to remain where he was in the North when the news hit that the mobs had been savagely beating freedom riders and sit-in activists in the South. But as you will learn, that's simply not the kind of man that Bob Moses is. We've got to go on to the registrar. That's what Moses said as blood was gushing down his head. We can't let something like this stop us. That's the whole point. Even while being mercilessly beaten by a group of racist thugs on the sidewalk, Moses would not let anything stop him from getting the volunteers he had with him that day over to the voting registrar. But when they got there, they were again refused the right to register, with blood gushing down their faces. Just like all those other times. Moses not only returned to the courthouse the next day, he marched straight up to the Amite County prosecutor and filed a complaint against his assailant for criminal assault. In 1961 Mississippi, the idea of a black man pressing charges against a white man was not only unheard of, it was the equivalent of asking to be murdered. Of course, within 2 hours of the charges being officially filed, at least 100 white people had descended into town from all across the county, many of them in pickups with shotgun racks. After testifying, Moses was moving through the crowd on his way outside when several gunshots sent the entire courthouse ducking for their lives. Luckily, no one was hit, but it did prompt the sheriff to send Moses and his friends on an emergency police escort to the county line. In the next day's paper, Moses found out that the all-white jury had acquitted his assailant. Mind you, all of this happened within Moses' first month moving from New York to Mississippi to start this work. His legend had already been born. As Branch writes, his name, borrowed from the most famous figure in the Old Testament, was acquiring a Christ-like ring within SNCC, where the story was repeated that he had clasped his hands and looked heavenward during the assault, saying, "Forgive them. Forgive them." Bob Moses, time and time again, put his body on the line for the sake of the freedom and dignity of a group of American people who had been so marginalized that they could not even vote in a county where they made up the majority of people. This is the 1960s, think about that. Moses saw his friends beaten, bloody, and even murdered simply for attempting to vote. Still, he continued to press on in his freedom struggle. And perhaps what's most impressive about this man is that he is as selfless and as humble as he is legendary. To again borrow Branch's words, Moses is a kind of priest who chose to isolate himself deep behind the lines of segregation for years at a time, armed only with nonviolence. A figure of relentless sacrifice against all conventional ambitions. Mr. Moses, there is nothing that any of us can say here that will ever fully be enough to honor your legacy. But I can think of one way for all of us here, at least to make a difference in your honor. When I first heard Mr. Moses speak in Boston a few years back, he talked about how this country in the 1960s had successfully made large strides in two critical pillars of our democracy: voting rights and access to health care. But that the third essential pillar, educational equity, had not yet been achieved. And he's right. America's schools in 2017 remain shamefully inequitable. The zip code that a child is born into can literally be the difference between that child going to Harvard and that child ending up in prison. Friends, if we really want to honor Bob Moses tonight, if we really want to honor those he fought with and those who died so that America could be closer to its ideals today than it ever was before, then you will join Bob Moses and you will join South Central Scholars in fighting for educational equity and opportunity today. I ask that you dedicate your time, your dollars, and your hearts to this fight. Together, I know we can help this country one day realize what Bob Moses has been fighting for his entire life. I think we've all heard enough of my speech. I'll let you hear from the living legend himself. Please put your hands together for Mr. Bob Moses.
Start of the 1964 freedom.